Okay. Let's turn things over to Jana Fine, our Youth Services Consultant.
Much, Melissa and Debbie. Well, welcome, welcome to our summer reminder that we've got Fizz Boom Read on the brain. It might be bubbling off at some point, but we want to keep it, you know, ready to go, and some great ideas are going to be coming your way. I'd like to introduce today's guest speakers. We have Carlos Villa and Jose Sanchez, and they're both from the National High Magnetic Field Lab here in Tallahassee. Welcome, guys.
Welcome, and thank you for having us here.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to be here.
Hey, Sanchez, one on the right there. And as Jana said, I work at the National High Magnetic Field Lab, and we work at the educational hub of the MAG Lab, which is known as the Center for Integrating Research and Learning.
And I'm Carlos Villa, I'm also with Jose in the Center for Integrating Research and Learning, and I'm the K-12 Education Outreach Coordinator, so things like field trips and tours of the lab are under my jurisdiction.
Okay, so a little overview of the Magnet Lab, right? So the Magnet Lab is a pretty unique place, and it's found, you know, right here in Tallahassee. It is part of Florida State University, but it's not on Florida State University's campus. It's about 2 miles away from its campus. It's unique because there are really only 12 Magnet Labs like this in the world, and we're the only one in the Western Hemisphere. We're also the largest and most high-powered in the world. So our magnets are stronger than any other magnetic field lab around. A little bit about what goes on at the Magnet Lab. So we have a user program, which we get approximately 1,300 to 1,400 visitors a year come to the Magnet Lab to do research, and they come from all over the world. The lab is funded by the National Science Foundation and the state of Florida. And offers free research to anyone that is willing to share the research findings that they do at the lab. But they, from time to time, we do have private companies that will come to the lab and research, not share it, but they have to pay for the time that they use the magnets there. So a lot of fields of research, but we've kind of summed it up into three little main categories, which is energy, materials, and life. Right, so as you can see there on that list, you know, we do material studies, we study their strength and all different properties of materials, but we also do biological studies where we have a very powerful MRI where we can image living things. So the department that Carlos and I work in is called the Center for Integrating Research and Learning. It's basically the educational hub of the Magnet Lab. So our main focus is really K-12 educational outreach. As you can see there, we see up to 6,000 students per year. We also provide professional development, such as the one we're doing right now, and with teachers local as well as non-local. And we also present at conferences of the country. Carlos and I just recently came back from Boston, right?
And then D.C.
For the NSTA conference. And then we went to the Science Expo in D.C., also a couple of weeks ago, and presented some cool magnet-related topics at that conference.
And we could actually be in Fort Lauderdale at the FCR STEM conference. So that's just another example of things that we're doing right now. So let's talk about magnets now. The gentleman you see right there is Nikola Tesla. He's one of our favorites at the lab. Brilliant scientist, and if you don't know about him, you really should look into him. Fantastic story. It's going to be a movie one day. Carl Friedrich Gauss, and Gauss is the first unit of measurement used for magnetic field strength, and 8 Gauss is not actually very strong. In fact, Earth's magnetic field, which is very large but very weak, is only half of 1 Gauss. So a Gauss, you know, refrigerator magnets being the hundreds of Gauss. But our lab, we need Tesla because Tesla is a larger unit, and it takes 10,000 Gauss to equal 1 Tesla. So at our lab, when we talk about the strengths of the magnets, we are going to talk in Teslas, and from here on out, I am going to talk in Teslas. So we go on the next slide. These are some common magnets that may be around you, around the lab, around the library or in your community. So basic refrigerator magnets are the first one, and when I'm thinking of a refrigerator magnet, I'm thinking of that plastic apple with a little black magnet on the back that you've got on your fridge. And of course, these are going to vary. They're all different types. but the standard and the average is about 0.03 Tesla. So 0.03 of a Tesla, those are strong enough to hold up your kids' artwork or whatever it is on the fridge, grocery list. Earth magnetic field, again, I mentioned it's very large, but it's also very weak. So Earth magnetic field you see is 0.00045 Tesla. That is about half a Gauss. A person's magnetic field, it's important to remember that our brain sends electrical impulses to our muscles to make them move. And as you're going to see later on, any type of electrical signal produces a magnetic field, strong or weak. But we have a very, very weak magnetic field because our muscles move based off of electrical impulses. So that's 3 × 10⁻³⁹ Tesla. That's a point followed by 13 zeros and then a 3. Extremely small field, but it is a field there. Typical junkyard magnets, those powerful ones at the end of cranes that they use to pick up and move the cars, are about 1 Tesla. So a nice feeling of how strong 1 Tesla is. And if you had an MRI done before, you're inside of an electromagnet that was creating a 2 to 3 Tesla field. At our lab, of course, our magnets get a lot stronger. And you can see here 9.4 Tesla for our ICR magnet, which is ionic cyclotron resonance. That's actually now the weakest magnet in that department. They've got an 11 Tesla that they've had for a while, and they are still installing a 21 Tesla magnet in that department. So sometime this summer, they'll be able to use that new magnet for research. Our 900 megahertz magnet is actually a very unique magnet. It is an NMR magnet, nuclear magnetic resonance. NMR and MRI are the same thing. Okay, so I made them interchangeably, and really the only difference is NMR, you're referring to research materials. MRI, you're referring to people, but the science, the technology, and the magnets are the same. Our NMR magnet is 21 Tesla. It's one of the strongest in the world. It has a very large opening, and we can do experiments on living organisms, so birds and lab rats, amoebas, other multicellular and single-cellular organisms. So a lot of research can be done in that magnet. Our resistive magnet, which is a standard electromagnet at the lab, go between 20 and 35, and, of course, that varies depending on the size of the experiment. Our split cell magnet is one of our newer ones. I think it's about 3 years old now, and it is essentially two very powerful magnets with a slight opening in the middle. And the best part about that magnet is, and I'll be honest, it's open in the middle so you can shoot laser beams into it. And that is just fun to say. So the 25 Tesla magnet, incredibly strong. There's only two of them in the world. Both were built in Tallahassee at our magnet lab. We kept one. There is in Germany now. 45 Tesla hybrid magnet is the strongest continuous field magnet in the world. It can be fired up to 45 Tesla, and the only limitation on how long we can run it is the amount of cooling water that we have available to it. So as long as we can keep it at the right temperature, we can run that magnet all day long. It's called a hybrid because it is part resistive and part superconducting, and like I mentioned, it is the strongest continuous field magnet in the world. Not strongest magnet because we have our pulse magnet, which is 100.7 Tesla, and those are actually run at Los Alamos National Lab at one of our branches in New Mexico, and that is one of the strongest magnets in the world, but it holds its field for a fraction of a second, and I'm talking in the millisecond range.
Wow.
So you have to keep that field, but you do get extremely powerful fields.
So you have to really know what you're doing.
Those are for very quick. I'll tell you what, it's a dream job because those magnets run for a fraction of a second and then 45-minute break. I'm all for that.
I have a brief question before you move on. You mentioned that you can do research inside the magnet. How does that work?
Well, the electromagnets are kind of like, they're like an MRI. So it's a tube and the inside is empty.
Okay.
So the bore is what the inside's called. That's where you put your experiment.
Okay.
So the smaller you make that bore, the stronger you're making the magnetic field. So our 45 Tesla magnet has a bore opening that's only 32 millimeters. Where the 20 Tesla resistive magnet has almost 20 millimeters to work with. So,
yeah, just to elaborate a little bit more on your question, right? So when you put something in a magnetic field, right, since we just discussed that everything has a tiny little magnetic field, regardless of what it is, if it's a person or if it's any material, the atoms have tiny little magnetic fields that are called spin,
mm-hmm.
right? And those tiny little magnetic fields interact with the big magnetic field that we provide, right? So we make a magnet. It has a very strong magnetic field. When you put something in it, all the little magnetic fields inside your sample, and whatever it is you're sticking in there, interact with the magnetic field that we created. So every element has different magnetic fields, and we can pick up those different magnetic fields and count them. So tell you exactly what is inside of a sample by the amount of those types of magnetic fields that we can pick up.
You're going to show
you.
Us that a little bit later.
We do talk a little bit about that
later.
So just to tell you a little interesting facts about magnets, right? So if you just took a regular bar magnet or any magnet, right, even magnets that we have at the lab, and you break it in half, right, you would still always have a north and a south pole, right? And the north and south pole are completely arbitrary. It's impossible to determine what is north and what is south unless you have another magnet. Really, the only thing you can do is determine they're opposites, or that they're the same. You know, if you took two magnets and they're both north ends together, they would repel, and you flip down, and you south with the north end, they would attract. But if you got a magnet that's right there in that picture and broke it in half, you still have a north and a south end. Now, you see a needle attached to the magnet there, right? So if you bring a needle and put it up to a magnet, you magnetize the needle. Well, if you cut that needle in half, you would also have a north and a south end. Right? And no matter how many times you do that, you will always have a north and a south end. In the lab, the magnets that we have at the lab, which are just a coil, right, which we'll describe a little bit later, if you took that, cut it in half, you would also have a north and a south end, right? But all magnets have magnetic fields. So different elements that are magnetic, and what is a surprise to a lot of students and a lot of people is that all metals are not magnetic. And you might notice if you have a stainless steel refrigerator at your house, right? You try to stick a magnet to it, nothing happens. So there are metals that are not magnetic. Stainless steel is one example. Aluminum is another example. Titanium. I mean, the list goes on and on. But there are several metals that are magnetic. Iron, nickel, and cobalt, right, happen to be magnetic. And if you look on the periodic table of elements, you will notice that all three of those are right next to each other, which goes in line with how the periodic table is arranged. Properties of elements are clumped together on the periodic table. But other metals that are magnetic, but they're not magnetic in a natural state. They have to be cooled, right, to extreme temperatures. So, for example, gadolinium is magnetic at 65 Fahrenheit and below, right? Anything above that, it's just a regular piece of metal, right? Dysprosium is a little more extreme. And for that to become magnetic, you have to go all the way down to 300 below zero Fahrenheit for it to become magnetic, right? So, metals are magnetic in an alloy form. So, like, for example, rare earth is also another type of metal that can become magnetic. And you can find those sometimes in stones that they have magnetic properties in them. So two types of magnets, really, and the two main types of magnets. There's permanent magnets and there are non-permanent magnets. And a permanent magnet is a magnet that, once magnetized, it will keep its magnetic field forever, technically. Right? Forever, yes, there are things that can destroy the magnetic field. Right? You can take a magnet and demagnetize it by doing a couple of things. One of them is by reaching its Curie point, right? And that was discovered by Pierre Curie. And iron, for example, the Curie point is 1,420 degrees Fahrenheit. So if you take a magnet and you raise it to that temperature, right, an iron magnet, and you raise it to that temperature, it'll stop being a magnet. The other thing you can do is run electricity through it, right? So that's funny because it's a double-edged sword. You can create a magnetic field using electricity, but you can also destroy a magnetic field using electricity. So if you were to run electrical current through a magnet, you would do what's called degauss it, and that takes away its magnetic field. Then the other thing you can do is bang it, right? Which basically, if you take a magnet and bang it hard enough with a hammer or throw it on the floor hard enough, you'll shake up all its little domains, and we'll talk about domains in a minute. And when those domains are all shook up, it loses its magnetic field.
Huh.
That we came up with, which is a lot of fun, and we like doing it, you know, mostly with younger students. We call it basically just magnet exploration, right? And it's an activity where they can discover certain properties about magnets on their own. And then what we'd like them to do is to communicate whatever it is they discover with the group. And some of, you know, it's funny to see all the different things they discover with magnets. So if you look at the picture there, orange bar at the top is a magnet. It's just got a little plastic handle. The little glass screen has got iron filings in it. And those things that look like marbles or Skittles are also tiny little magnets, right? And then those two are just regular paper clips. And then other magnets, the spherical magnets and the little square magnets, you give those all to the students in a kit and then just tell them to play with it and tell me something that you just realized about playing with these magnets, right? And then the students will do fun things like, you know, put the magnet under the table and move the ball around on the top of the table, right? And they think that that's great. And then the other thing, maybe they can take the two circular magnets and put them on a pencil, right? As we give them a wood dowel. Mm-hmm. And they'll see that if they put the magnets one way, the two magnets will just stick. They flip one of the magnets, they'll flip one on top of the other. So that's a little cool activity that we like doing with the students, and it's very simple, and you don't really need too much materials.
Yeah, the thing about attraction and repulsion is that you don't really need to teach attraction and repulsion to the kids. You give them the magnets, they'll figure it out on their own. You may have to give them the terminology, the wording of it, but the fact that magnets attract and repel, they're going to figure that out all on their own, so you don't need to teach that to them.
And you can get these, I know that you can get like the little circular ones and the little square ones at any Ace Hardware or any mm-hmm. hardware store or general store. But iron filings, where would you get those?
You buy iron filings in a, they come in a little tube. You could probably go to any machine shop and they want to just sweep them off the floor and put them in a jar for you.
Please, sir, may I have them?
The iron filings, that they are a mess. They get on the magnet, they're almost impossible to take off.
That's why you need to keep them inside a little plastic container like that.
And a lot of the educational companies do sell a pre-cased batch of iron filings. So it's in a sealed container. You don't have to worry about them getting out. They're not openable unless you break it and shatter.
Sure.
So and that keeps everything inside. And this is what I use when I go into the classroom, and it just eliminates the mess completely.
And the little round.
Also very popular. You can find those. I've seen them in places like Walmart even.
Oh, okay. Cool. Sorry. Well, you know, if they were interested, they
could know. Yeah, absolutely. So the other group of magnets is a temporary magnet. And essentially, this is a material that is attracted to a magnet, but not necessarily hold its field. So things like paper clips that were in the previous kit. Nails and screws and a screwdriver and scissors and thumbtacks and even the refrigerator door, as long as it's not stainless steel.
Okay.
All those things are temporary magnets. So if you take a magnet up to a group of paper clips or staples, they're all going to attract to that magnet. And what you don't see is that when they're attracted to that magnet, they get to that magnetic field, every one of those materials becomes its own magnet. Now, take them all off and they fall to the table again. When they impact the table, a lot of these materials will lose their field again, and they just become ordinary staples again. But the good thing is you can do a lot of cool things if you keep them magnetized. So if you go to the next slide, I love working with paper clips, and paper clips are a lot of fun. And when I was in Boy Scouts, I remember they told us that if you get lost, you can make your own compass, and we'll talk about that too later. But you can take a needle and stroke it 100 times in the same direction to magnetize it. And now I've learned more of the science. I realized that the first time I did it, it was magnetized, and the other 99 times were just busy working. So you take these paper clips and you put them on the magnet or even in the magnetic field. Those paper clips are instantly magnetized. And what I like to do is I like to take a strong magnet, put a paper clip underneath it, and then take another paper clip and put that on the paper clip. So I've got two paper clips hanging together from the one magnet. Now, what happens is each of these paper clips has become magnetized. And if you take away the magnet and just have those two paper clips hanging off each other, they will stay magnetized. So these two paper clips are attracted to each other. They have a north and a south pole. They have a field around them. You can make them attract and you can make them repel. It's very cool. And they will stay this way. I know I had a teacher contact me and write me an email saying, hey, those paper clips that you left hanging in my classroom, that was 3 years ago, and they're still attracted to each other. So even though they're temporary, that doesn't mean weak. It doesn't mean short. It just means that if you drop them, they will lose their field. And if you
lose their field very easily.
Right, very easily. And if you go to that teacher's classroom and I drop those on the floor, their field would be gone. So that's what a temporary magnet is. So you can play with paper clips and a magnet magnet and see some very interesting things with these temporary magnets.
Just for the record, that picture you see there is actually not exactly what we do. I would say that that's not a picture representing what we do, because the paper clips there are clipped together.
Well, not just that, but we've also got that plastic coating on them working against it. Get ordinary steel paper clips and they work. You can
Carlos put that picture there because it's cool.
Colorful. Yeah, but you can just use the ordinary stamp paper clips. You get 100 of them in the box. Don't get anything fancy, nothing colorful, just the standard ones. Moving on. Okay, let's talk about those domains that we've talked about. Let's talk about what makes a magnet happen. First of all, Jose almost caught me on this. That is not a typo. Tomos is the Greek word for what an atom is. It means indestructible. So we know now that the atom is indestructible. It does break down into further parts, but that's the original thinking of what an atom was. So inside the atom, we have the protons, the neutrons, and the electrons. Every one of them is important. Every one of them is essential. I don't care about the first two when it comes to magnetism. It's the electrons that are important. It's the electrons that are essential for what happens with magnetism. So let's talk about what makes a magnet happen. And you all notice that we have a link on this next slide. So go click on that. There's a Java tutorial that talks about magnetic domains and how you magnetize stuff, but this is what happens. Electrons spin, and as the electrons spin, what they want to do is they pair up inside of a shell, and one spins up and the other spins down, and they cancel out. That's called the Pauli exclusion principle. For everyone that's spinning up, the next one has to spin down. They cancel each other out, and essentially you have a disorganized state because all these electrons are going in opposite directions, and there is no organization to that. And that's what you see on the bottom sphere, all these electrons randomly spinning but canceling each other around. Now, you follow the arrow and you go to the next picture, you see that we have some organization. We have some electrons spinning together. Those are those domains. In these domains, these electrons are influencing each other and they are starting to spin together. Now, this doesn't happen in anything. Nickel and cobalt are the materials that lend this to happen. So in iron, nickel, and cobalt, these domains happen, and groups start spinning together. And it looks great, but we still don't have a magnet. This step, but we don't have a magnet yet. What we need to do is we need these domains to spin together. So when you get these domains spinning together, that's when you have a magnet. And in this image you have here, you see that the electrons are spinning one direction. That happens to be in the north, and spinning away from south. And when you look at this image and you imagine two of these spheres going against each other, north against north, the arrows are pointing against each other and they're going to repel. But if north against south, they're spinning in the same direction and they will attract. And that's why these things happen. It's about the spin of the electrons. So I want to emphasize that the Curie point, or electricity, or banging it, is going to disrupt the magnetic field. Oh, and one more thing about this image. Not all of the domains are lined up. The reason that all those domains are not lined up is because that's practically impossible to do. You have some that are going left and some that are going right. The great thing about those left and right is that they are canceling each other out, so they're not affecting the magnetic field. If that group right in the middle, slightly off to the left, they are not lined up. They're not contributing to the magnetic field. In fact, they are weakening the magnet by going against where everyone else wants to go. If you could take that little group and line it up, your magnet becomes stronger.
Yeah.
If you could take a field and go the opposite direction, you're making it weaker.
So one of the things that relates to this picture right here and what Carlos is talking about, we call it at the lab homogeneity. So it's very difficult, I say impossible because I don't think anything is impossible, it's very, very, very difficult to get all of the domains to line up. And in the lab, we have some magnets that we've created and some magnetic fields that we've created that have an extremely high homogeneity. But even then, you still have tiny little imperfections that just don't allow you to get that perfect homogeneity. But the closer you get to that, the better your magnet's going to be.
Yeah, the magnets are specialized just for that very precise field. And we have some other magnets that are stronger, but not as even.
Homogeneous, right.
Right. I think you can do with magnet, and for this I am going to suggest that you use a neodymium magnet. It will work much better. So there are different types of magnets, obviously. There's some ceramic magnets, there's iron magnets. Alnico is one of my favorites, and Alnico stands for aluminum nickel cobalt, Alnico. But you need a neodymium magnet for the next two slides I'm going to show you. And those are pretty easy to find now. They're very powerful, so be careful with them. Definitely don't put it next to your wallet. That's about your credit cards. But you want that neodymium magnet. And usually they're abbreviated NIB. So coins, American currency, are not magnetic. Coins are copper nickel alloy, like the dimes and the quarter are. Pennies are copper plated, but there's zinc on the inside. If you find one of the old pennies, they're copper all the way through. But coins are not magnetic, not American coins anyways. It's our bills that are magnetic, and that surprises a lot of people. But if you take a dollar bill and you look at it and you see all that ink and all that writing, that's iron-rich ink. It is magnetic. So if you lay a bill flat on the table and you put a strong neodymium magnet over it, it will attract. It will move towards the magnet. You may not be able to pick it up off the table, but you will definitely see it attracting towards the magnet. I mentioned American coins are not magnetic because a lot of foreign coins are. I know from my experience, Canadian, British, Brazilian, Mexican, a lot of these other countries use iron coins, so those coins are magnetic, but the United States is not one of those countries. You can go to the bank and ask for any foreign currency, and you can test out to see what works and what doesn't work. Now, you really want to get your kids' attention. Put a blender one day and fill about three-quarters away with water. Put a dollar bill in there and then blend it. And yes, you are destroying the dollar bill. I know that's bad. And it'll get a dollar every time you want to do this activity. But you take that neodymium magnet up against the side of the glass of the blender. And as everything's whirring around, the iron from the ink is going to get pulled out of the dollar. And it'll attract to the neodymium magnet. And when you stop the blender and everything starts falling to the bottom, and remember, dollar bills aren't paper. They're more cloth than anything. So all that cloth starts falling down to the bottom, the iron is going to be attracted to the side of the glass where the magnet is. So you have a little black chunk of iron right up against the neodymium magnet on the side of that. Fine. So that's a great attention getter to use in the classroom.
So another of our activities that we have, and this is the link you see there. I encourage you to go to it, and you can look at the Java tutorial that relates to this. Basically, you can. One of the things about magnets that we want to emphasize on and want people to understand is that magnets have magnetic fields that come out of them, right? They come out of one side and go to the other side, right? And these are called magnetic field lines. So pretty much any magnet, whether it's a bar magnet or a coil like we have at the Mag Lab, have magnetic field lines coming out of them. A good way to demonstrate those magnetic fields lay outside of a magnet is you take a series of compasses, right? And if you have, you can do it with 6 to 8 compasses. You know, if you know a compass needle is actually a tiny little magnet, north and a south end. If you were to bring the compass next to a magnet, it would deflect. The compass needle would get deflected. And the north part of the compass needle would be attracted to the south part of the magnet. So if you have all these compasses and you arrange them around like you see in that picture, you'll notice that the north end will point away from the north side of the magnet. And then you just draw a line basically pointing away from the north end of that compass. And you keep doing that around the magnet. And you'll notice it will form a, basically like a ring all the way around right back into the southern part of the magnet. You can actually trace magnetic field lines with the electivity.
So you get really lost if you were out in the wild doing that. You
yeah,
wouldn't know where to go.
You wouldn't know where to go. And actually, what's curious about playing with this on a magnet is whenever you put a compass needle up to a magnet, you actually flip the magnetic field inside of the compass.
Really?
So you'll end up with a magnet that'll point south instead of north.
Okay.
So you got to be careful with that. You always have to make sure and test that compass needle is pointing north.
How do you
and
do
it,
that?
You got to know which way is north. So that's, like I said, there's no way, it is something that is impossible to determine what the north and south end of a magnet, unless you have another magnet and you know what is the north and south end of that magnet.
Oh, wow.
The magnet by itself, the only way you can determine that it is a magnet is if you have another magnet next to it. Because if I gave you two iron bars, one of them is a magnet and one of them isn't, you would not determine which one is a magnet.
Yeah.
It's impossible because they would attract to each other.
Sure.
So you say, well, which one's doing the attracting? Because you can't see the attraction, you can only feel the attraction.
Right.
So that happens. You got to be careful with compasses and magnets. If you bring a compass near a magnet, you will flip its magnetic field, and you will end up going south instead of north. You end up in Brazil watching the World Cup instead of the North Pole.
So we have a couple of questions. One of those, where can you get the magnets?
I mean, magnets are pretty to find. If you do a search online, Amazon has a lot of them. We have a favorite company. It's K&J Magnetics. They sell really quality magnets.
Of all shapes. And sizes and strengths and prices.
Yeah, a ridiculous amount of magnets. Tiny, smaller than coin magnets, and then the one we just bought, which is almost the size of your hand, which is extremely dangerous, but so much fun to work with. So Case does a lot of great magnets, but Amazon, you can search for neodymium or NiV magnets.
And you can get a very, very, very strong magnet for like $15.
Yep.
I'm talking very strong. Yeah.
You can do all kinds of...
All stuff we talked about with the dollar bill, it'll do all that.
Just be careful with them because they can be dangerous.
Yeah, I'm just thinking in a public library, if you go through, if they have security gates and you have a bed, that's going to degout it, right?
Well, I just went to Barnes & Noble, actually, to do the activity night. I took our electromagnetic launcher, and as soon as I walked through the door, I set off the detector. I didn't even think about it. I was like, well, what am I carrying with me? But electromagnetic launcher having a strong magnetic field is interfering with the So every time I walked in, every time I walked out with that, the alarms went off.
Interesting.
We have a question. Why are strong magnetic magnets dangerous?
Okay, so the reason why they're dangerous is not because the magnetic field does anything to anybody. The thing is that it's so powerfully attracted to other magnetic materials that it will pull something off a table and smash your hand.
Mm-hmm.
So you have the magnet in your hand, and you walk by a table, let's just say, with a nail on it. That will get pulled towards your hand. Not like it's gently pulled towards your hand. It is rapidly pulled towards your hand. We had someone at the lab carrying a neodymium magnet that walked by another neodymium magnet, and it ended up going to the hospital because it smashed his index finger.
Yeah.
The point where it was completely flat.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
But the magnet by itself is
not dangerous.
It's
going to
get too...
touch it and put it up to you and nothing's going to happen. But, again, if something magnetic, like your glass, or something, it will pull it away from there. That's why they're dangerous.
Not just that, take the magnet by itself and put it up to something like a computer, you could erase the information on the computer,
yeah.
You can wipe out credit cards. So
you can
go in
your little swipe card to get in here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Magnets can be dangerous, but the personal danger, the health danger, is when you're talking about two magnets together, the smearing effect.
So what effect does these giant magnets have on all of the people that work there?
There is no evidence at all of effects that magnetic fields have on people.
Yeah.
There's no studies that show that it...
it wouldn't cause anything necessarily, but there are, people...
If you think
people,
about
are
it...
Are people drawn to you? I mean, that's really bad. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
But, it's...
Very attractive people.
Yeah.
When you think about it, when you're getting an MRI, you are in a very powerful magnetic field. You're in the very bore of a very strong electromagnet, and you are being affected by that magnetic field. But as soon as that machine is turned off, you go completely back to the way you were. As opposed to an X-ray, when you stand in front of the X-ray, radiation is being shot through your body. And it's completely different because, yes, your body can get rid of that small amount of radiation. You're fine. But you get the MRI... There's nothing about, you have to wait 5 days before you get another MRI. You're completely back to normal.
It's not as if these magnets are on all the time either because they're...
Yeah, we turn them on and off, right?
Right. They would have to generate an order.
Yeah.
Right.
Some people have asked if, what happened to the iron in your blood, right? At very, very, very high magnetic fields, we don't know. We have no idea what will happen. But at the field we have at the lab, even 45 Tesla, iron in our blood is not like an iron filing. It's not like a nail. It's a iron, right?
Yeah.
So it's not exactly pure iron.
So it doesn't have the same effect.
It doesn't have the same effect as a regular piece of iron would have. So
yeah.
It won't rip the iron out of your body or anything like that people think.
That right. And we were talking the other day about people being magnetic.
Mm-hmm.
like Magneto.
Magneto, right.
You know, there's that scene in the movie, in one of the X-Men movies, I forget which one it is, but Magneto around all these people, and if it was a matter of affecting our bodies, he could just freeze everybody and nobody would be able to move. But there's the scene in it where he takes a guard and he freezes the guard and takes his keys. And before Magneto takes that guard and captures him, that guard falls asleep or is seduced or something happens to him and he gets injected with extra iron. And that's one of those parts where the movie's actually very accurate because the amount of iron in your blood isn't going to do anything.
Sure.
But if you get injected with that extra iron,
sure,
that's when the supervillain can take over.
So don't do that at work, okay? Please don't. We had somebody famous come and visit, didn't you?
Magneto. Met two famous people, three famous people, I think, but two really famous people. Neil deGrasse Tyson,
yeah,
came to the lab, and that was cool. We all met him, and I also met Magneto. Pretty cool. I gave him a tour and have a picture with him. And
his name is Sir Ian McKellen?
Sir Ian McKellen,
is that right?
Yeah. That's the
about the seeing field lines, and I'm jumping on Jose's slide, but if you go to the next slide, and I've seen the seeing magnetic field lines, and we need the activity to see them, but we know at least one animal now on this planet that can visually see magnetic field lines, and I could give it away, but if you do a quick Google search, you can find that, and I think it'll be more fun for them to look it up. So there's an animal, it's a bird, on this planet, a specific type of bird, not all of them. There's a bird on this planet that can see magnetic field lines, so I'll hand it back.
So this little activity and this slideshow, we've created a series of slideshows that cover all the little activities that we've done, but this one in particular, that's Pat Dixon, our former director, that goes over basically this activity with the compasses and a little magnet step by step and shows you exactly what to do and how to do it. Activity that's fun, it's also outlined on the website there, is creating a compass, right? So like Carlos talked about as a Boy Scout, you can find your way if you lose, you know, if you don't have a compass, you can create a compass. Of course, you have a magnet, right? So everybody carries a magnet around. If you do happen to have a magnet with you, you can create a compass by just taking a needle. Oh, by the way, you also have to have a needle.
or
a paper clip. Right? So then you just bring the needle up to the magnet, and then that needle becomes a magnet, right? And then all you have to do is find a way to float that needle in water. So if you were to put it on a leaf, for example, right? Let's be very green about this and use a leaf, right? Or you can use a bar straw or even a cork from like a wine bottle or something like that. And it's fun because you can, you know, find different ways to try to float this needle on there. And once it's magnetized, the needle will point towards the north end of, the north. Magnetic north. But, you know, and if you have a magnet, you would know when you put the needle up to the magnet and you have north and the south end, realize that the needle itself is going to be the complete opposite of the way you put it on the magnet. So if you put it on the magnet with like north on the left and south on the right, then needle's left side will be the south side. And the right will be the north. So it's the opposite of what the magnet is. And that way when you put it in the water, it'll align magnetic north of the Earth.
Cool.
So now you know one of the activities is outlined again in our little slideshows. That's me there. So I go over step by step, do it, and there's pictures on the slideshow of how it works. And I think I used a piece of cork in mine, but you can float it with a bar straw. It'll work, or on a leaf.
All right, so let's talk about, since we've mentioned it before, electricity and magnetism. They are very closely related, so much so that on it I should be talking about electromagnetism, not these two separate things. So the rule is that where you have electricity, you have magnetism. That's all going to be true. And where you have magnetism, you can create electricity. Again, that is always true. Let's talk about how this happens and why this happens. So electricity is the flow of electrons. So with a wire carrying electricity, electrons are flowing from one place to another. That's what the electricity is. In direct current or DC electricity, all the electrons are flowing together in the same direction. Because they're all going in the same direction, all these electrons are spinning in the same direction. And if you remember what we talked about before, when electrons are spinning in the same direction, you create a magnetism. So A wire carrying electricity in direct current has a magnetic field around it because the electrons are moving together in the same direction. So it's just a permanent magnet, except instead of just spinning in place, they are spinning and moving together. So that means, again, in the white, you can see there, every wire carrying electricity has a weak magnetic field around it. So if you start looking around your library, all these things that are using electricity, like the clock, the laptop, the phone, your watch, your cell phones, all these materials have a magnetic field around them. It's very weak, but it is there. So how do you make it stronger? You concentrate it. You take that wire, you wrap it up into a coil, and when you do that, the inside of that coil becomes magnetic. Like these electromagnets here. So you make this electromagnet by taking a piece of copper wire, and it doesn't have to be copper, but copper is great. It's a great conductor. You wrap it into a coil, and you need the electricity, and that's where the battery comes in. When the electricity is pushing the electrons into that coil, the inside of it becomes very strongly magnetic. That you can put an iron rod or an iron nail or something that's magnetic inside that coil, and it will be magnetized. Same as putting a paper clip up against a permanent magnet. And when you do that, you've created an electromagnet. This coil, same shape as an MRI, which is essentially a coil. So you could open the MRI and look inside of it. That's what makes the MRI happen. It's a big coil of wire, and the wire and the more electricity you have, the stronger it's going to get.
Magnets, right? There's a couple of things about electromagnets that you should know, especially if you were going to be making an electromagnet, right? To make it more powerful, there's several things that affect the magnetic field, right? Number one is how neatly you wrap the coil around your bore. So at the magnet lab, we actually have a winding department, right, which winds the coils, and they do the standard to which they wind their coils is very, very high. So that's part of what makes a magnet strong. Also, the number of turns that you put in your coil. So the more turns you put in your coil, think about it. That wire has a magnetic field around it. So if you make one loop, concentrating a few magnetic field lines in the middle. If you do two loops, you're concentrating twice as many magnetic fields. So every time you create a loop, right, increasing your magnetic field over and over again. So if you put hundreds of loops, hundreds of coils, you would have a very, very powerful magnet. So some of the magnets at our lab have literally thousands of turns in them.
Yeah, if not millions or
something. Some of them may even have up to a million turns. So thing is the gauge of your wire. So how thick or how thin your wire is going to affect how much current you can run through it. And the factor is battery strength, which means the amount of current. The more current you can run through the wire, the stronger your magnetic field is going to be. And there's two other things. Temperature, right? So obviously, if you make this too hot, if you put it in a pot of boiling water, it would increase the resistance, reducing your current, which would reduce your magnetic field. But if you stuck it in a very cold, let's say ice bath or something, let's just go crazy and say you stuck it in liquid nitrogen, right? You would reduce the resistance in the wire, increasing your current, right, would increase your magnetic field. And finally, that's not mentioned on here is the So if you make, like, MRIs, for example, the reason why they're only 1 and 2 and 3 Tesla is because the bore has a huge diameter. The bigger diameter, the weaker your magnetic field. If you were to concentrate that into a tiny little radius, let's say 1 inch in diameter or 2 inches in diameter, your magnetic field goes up significantly.
Yeah, the 35 Tesla magnet has a bore that's 32 millimeters. And that, of course, has to be large enough for a person to fit inside of it, so you're losing strength by adding space.
Yeah. Our MRI magnet at the lab only has a 6-inch bore. That's why we're able to get it to 21 Tesla. If you make it big enough to stick like a body in there, like a human, it would go to like 5 or 6 Tesla.
Yeah, I think the strongest magnets for human use, I think, are only about 7 or 8 Tesla. And that's at the University of Florida at our third site facility where they do a lot of spinal cord injuries, brain research, and those are not diagnostic. If you get sick, you're not going to be using the 7 Tesla magnet. Those are purely experimental.
How large the coils, does it depend on the mechanism that you're putting it in, or is it tiny, or are there...
They vary in size, actually. Some of them are very small, The samples that you can put in them are literally the size of a pen cap. I mean, that's literally how big the sample is. So we're talking samples that are like in liquid form, and then you can stick them in there. And and then the 21 Tesla MRI magnet, that's got a 6-inch bore. So you can stick rats and finches, small birds, you know, something like an eagle. You couldn't stick an eagle or something big like that in there, but a small bird you can fit in there.
And then Jose mentioned those because those are the animals that we've seen used at the
at
lab.
The lab.
Let me emphasize that the animals go in alive and come out alive.
Yes.
Because some people get concerned about, oh my God, they go in the fields killing them. No, they go to sleep, and not like dead sleep, but they go to sleep, they put them in, and while they're asleep, they're inside the field, and that's where we do the research. But the magnet field does not harm any of the animals. The 20 Tesla NMR magnet that Jose mentioned is not the strongest NMR magnet in the world, but for its size, it is the strongest, and that's why it's so popular, because they can do live animal research at extremely high fields.
So again, we have another slideshow, that's me again, showing you how to make an electromagnet. And again, it's just pictures and me talking in the background, explaining how the electromagnet is made and what makes it strong and what makes it weak.
Now, so we'd like to talk about magnets. I figure you guys want to see some more magnet stuff. So on the next slide, we've got a couple of resources that you can use. My favorite is the Stop Faking It series. Bill Hartson, I've met him a couple times. He's a great author, and he writes these books for teachers, and they are called Stop Faking It, so that when you go into the classroom, you can know what you're talking about it and not fake it. But the Electricity and Magnetism book covers the topic very well. It's very thorough, and it's very easy to read. So that's a very good book to pick up, the Stop Faking It, Electricity and Magnetism.
And the other book by Livingston, Driving Force, is, I love it because it only goes into the science behind magnets, but it also always answers the question that the general public's always asking. Why do you need a stronger magnet? Why are magnets important? Why are you trying to build a new 51 Tesla magnet? Why do you guys want to reach 100 Tesla? Why is that important? This book addresses all of those things, but it also tells you, hey, you know what? Your cell phone that you're using, guess what? There's a magnet in there. You know what? Without that magnet, there'd be no cell phone. You know that beer at home that you blend that dollar bill with or that you shake with without a magnet? You wouldn't have, you know, the electricity you have in your house. Guess what? Without magnets, you wouldn't have electricity in your house. At least, you know, it goes into MRIs and it talks about all the science behind it. Basically, a lot of the things that we talked about here, they address in that book. So Driving Force is a really, really awesome book that talks about magnets.
We have a YouTube site. So the National High Magnetic Field Lab, NHMFL, has a YouTube site. You can go there and see not just the slideshows that we talked about, the audio slideshows that we talked about, but you can also see some of the recordings from our science cafes where we scientists into a non-science situation, such as a local restaurant, and they get to talk with the public about science. So it's a chance for us to encourage a science conversation between scientists and the general public. As well as a few other cool little videos that we've got on our website.
I love that idea. I think that would be one of the easy ideas for this summer, is a local scientist of whatever capacity.
Mm-hmm.
And if you come to library and just sit down with the youth or the adults and talk about what they do.
What I like about it, it's my favorite type of thing is informal learning, and it's just really a casual way, non-threatening, right? Because just hanging out, talking, it's like if I was just having a conversation with you. It's not like this classroom setting where you have to be quiet and
right.
I'm the one talking and nobody can talk. And it's great because the conversations are, you never know what people are going to ask.
That's
so
true.
It's a really interesting way of educating.
And I'm always amazed by how surprised that scientists are so normal.
Yeah.
And you know,
wait a second,
we are. We, me and Jose, we're
you go to restaurants?
We love baseball. We'll talk as much as we talk science.
You know,
and
except for that little flashing light on the back of your head.
Right, yeah.
Right.
I'm going to plug myself
into the matrix.
On our website, too, we've got a lot more resources that you can check out. The Java tutorials are a lot of fun. If you can't get materials and bring them in, go on our website, jump on these Java tutorials, and it's the same as playing with these materials virtually. So you can move the magnets, you can change the power, you can do a lot of really cool stuff with these Java tutorials.
There's also information on the website there for teachers. All of our K-12 programs are listed on there. We have a little listserv, email listserv, even though Jim didn't call it a listserv, that basically what we call a Educators Club. It doesn't cost anything. We call it a club because if you join in there, you'll get all the information that we want to disseminate to educators.
Nice.
And then this is what the website looks like currently. You can request magnet time. So if you have an idea, and Jose mentioned that, we run the experiments for free as long as you share the research. And we have taken ideas from the atypical scientist, somebody that's just sitting at home says, huh, I have an idea, and they suggest the idea, and our group gets together and goes, my gosh, that's a really good idea. Let's bring them in, and we will run these experiments as long as we share what we learn. So you can, you yourselves can request magnet time.
Wait, I have a question that came in, and this person wants to know how to adapt this information to a 5 elementary school setting. How does it fit into the Florida standards?
Well, can we go back one slide? Let's go back two slides, because on our resources, you see the Magnet Lab website, there's education at the top, and you click on the education tab, it takes you to our site, and there are 4 teacher tabs and 4 student tabs, and one of the things that we offer for teachers is outreach, which means we come out to the classroom and we do activities, or we can come out to your group, Boy Scout groups, library groups we've done before, and we can do these activities. Now, on our website, we've got activities that you can do before our visit and after our visit, and all of those activities are tied in with the Sunshine State Standards.
So it's listed on there that it ties into.
There's a picture in that you really can't go out, because we've got people from all of Florida on this webinar today.
Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you
unless
what,
you cut yourself up into 15 different pieces.
It doesn't hurt to ask. That's
it's
what I'll
okay.
tell everybody.
So if you
we
might
have
be
gone
in the area, for example, if you're in Fort Lauderdale, like you said, and then you've got people that might be interested in having you come to it for a program.
Absolutely. In fact, we've outreached out. Traditionally, we try and stay a couple hours away, so out as far west as Pensacola, as far east as Jacksonville and southern Georgia. But, you know, it doesn't hurt to ask, and that's how we get to these areas like Panama City Beach. The teacher calls us and asks us, and we brainstorm and figure out how can we do this. And we
or sometimes, you know, somebody, let's say, from down south, let's just or Orlando or Tampa or maybe even South Florida, Fort Lauderdale, and we'll go to the FAST conference and say, we can't do it on the day that you're requesting. However, we will be there in October for the FAST conference. How about we go to your school on Monday?
Yeah.
And things like that. And that would be something that's We do it all the time.
Yeah, so I'll say that to everybody. It doesn't hurt to ask.
Absolutely. I think that's great.
Other questions?
I don't know. We're waiting to see if anybody has any, you know, magnetism questions to ask.
You mentioned the split magnet going with the lasers. What happens to the laser that goes in between those?
But, well, actually, the reason they did that is because prior to the split coil being invented, there would be no way for you to interact with the sample. So you put your sample in this little tube, right, and it goes all the way down into the middle of the magnet, then you would just record the data and pull it out. There was no way for you to do anything to the sample while it was in there. But now that they have the split coil magnet, there's these ports where you can shine a laser through it. And what they do is they'll take like a crystal that they're imaging in the magnet, and as they're imaging it in the magnet, they'll fire a laser into the crystal and basically destroy the crystal, which tells them a lot. I don't know if you know a lot, but in science, they destroy things and learn about them.
Sure.
It's just the way it is. I mean, so they'll destroy these crystals and image it as happening to learn about, okay, so what happens to the crystal at this temperature? Does it deform? Does it still conduct electricity? Is it, you know, what are its properties as it's being destroyed by this laser? The lasers we have at the lab aren't like your little regular pointer lasers that you can play with. Right. These are class 3 lasers. You know, the kind that, like a lightsaber. It'll burn.
We don't have lightsabers.
We don't have lightsabers.
But let me say, not yet. I didn't realize how true that is. We learn about stuff by breaking it. We really do. How does the TV work? Take it apart, see what's on the inside. How do atoms work? We take it apart, see what's on the inside. So, yeah, we grow these crystals, and I know it's very difficult for them to grow these crystals. They work for weeks to get a batch of a dozen, and then 2 of them will work, and the 2 crystals go to the magnet and get destroyed so we can learn about it.
Yeah.
And crystal research is very important right now. Superconductors is the way of the future. Semiconductors are very crucial for computers and electronics right now. All that stems from crystals.
We've got a question. Do you use liquid nitrogen to cool your magnets?
Yes, we do, actually. We use liquid nitrogen and liquid helium. liquid nitrogen can be used to cool the magnets that run with high temperature superconductors, right? So we have two types of superconductors, high temperature and low temperature. So the low temperature superconductors only work with liquid helium. Liquid helium is at 4 Kelvin. Minus 450 degrees Fahrenheit.
Don't
want to
put your toe in that.
You do not want to put your toe in that. And liquid nitrogen is 77 Kelvin.
To minus 321.
Minus 321. I'm just checking facts here, Carlos. 321 below zero. So, yes, the long answer that I just gave you to the question you asked, we do use liquid nitrogen to cool the magnets.
However, the resistive magnets, we actually just used deionized water. So standard well water, and then we deionize it by taking out all the impurities, and then it's just pure H2O that goes in very cold, and then comes out very hot. And our hybrid magnet uses 4,000 gallons a minute.
What happened to all that water?
It's recycled.
Yep, it's purified, cooled, and put right back into the magnet.
Very cool.
All they got to do is filter it, because when it comes out the other side, it does have impurities from the magnet.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Wow. That's fascinating stuff.
Yeah.
You know, anybody who doesn't think about magnets, hopefully think about magnets in a new way, because magnets are us, basically. Thank you all, both Carlos and Jose, very much.
It's our pleasure.
We have their emails and phone numbers up on the screen if you're interested in speaking more with them about the possibility if they're going to be in your area, or if you have a question about anything or an idea that turned out to be a really great idea that we can share with you. Next webinar will be rolling out the new approved kids infobits on the moon. And there's another webinar prepared by Julie Papera from the ALS Engage group on June 12th. And she's going to talk to you about that. And right after that, we'll be rolling out that new data. So we hope that you'll join us for that. And as we have some things, July and August, we have some special ones. We're with our guys back in the fall to talk about
the
nature of science, get you all stemmed up for the fall school year. And I am actually looking for, I had an idea, and this might be a brain moment for me perhaps, but in thinking about working with teen volunteers in the past that I've worked with, how they worked and how they did. If you've got current teen volunteers you could talk about. And also what happens when they leave you, where they go. Do they grow up? What do they do? Does the influence of the library have anything to do with their lives? I think that would be really interesting. And so if you have any ideas for that, please email me, and we'll look forward to seeing you again next month. Thanks for joining us.
Hey guys, this is Melissa. We'll be on for a couple more minutes in case you guys have questions, but if not, thanks for being on with us, and we'll see you guys next time.
Okay, well, thank you for thanking us.
Yes, you're welcome. And then please, if you do have questions about magnetism or really anything in science, we'll do our best to help you out.
Mm-hmm.
This is just a real conversation, but when they talk about degaussing appliances or something along those lines, that's demagnetizing, basically,
yep.
Isn't it?
Yeah, the monitors, the old computer monitors, when you remember the old box TV screens,
mm-hmm.
You turn it off and it had that big thump sound, that was the degaussing itself. And of course, in World War II, they used to degauss the entire ships so that the sensitivity to the mines that the Nazis were using in the oceans. Yeah, based off of magnetism. That way, if a whale hit the mine, it wouldn't explode. It needs a ship. If he magnetized the ship, it has an effect.
Clever. You guys end up being here. What happened?
I wish when I graduated from FSU, they're waiting for me. I'll take it.
I was a teacher for 7 years in Miami. And I was part of a program that they had here at the Magnet Lab.
Got drawn to it.
And I got drawn to it.
It never stopped.
I know. There's so many. And you hear them. And you hear them all the time, don't you?
Our favorite T-shirt at the lab is a picture of a hybrid magnet. and it says, I'm cool, because it's got liquid helium in it, and the back of it says, attractive. Favorite shirt.
Yeah, that's a good one.
That's great. That's great. Well, I'm sure kids just throw a match up. Left right, don't they?
I get introduced as the most attractive.
There's nothing wrong with that. Except your wife is with you. Wait a minute. That's not necessarily true.
She's a science geek, too, so she gets it.
Oh, that's